Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also. The body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me. But now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior. Plunge me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Burdens are lifted at Calvary, Calvary, Calvary. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. That's how it is with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you spread his love to everyone. You want to pass it on. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah! Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! We are going to see the King. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame. joy of the Lord. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, 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 holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before.
I've seen you move.
I've seen you move.
I've seen you move.
You move the mountains.
And I believe.
And I believe.
And I believe.
I'll see you do it again.
Still be my vision, O ruler of all.
No, I won't be afraid.
Each day. Oh, 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 you Welcome to Spa Church. We're so glad you're here.
We're open. Registration opens Thursday at 9 a.m. for the following service. Go to our website or call the office to save a seat.
11 a.m. starts family service. Join us for family service that's conducive for kids. There'll be videos, games, worship, a Bible lesson, and so much more.
There'll be take-home bags for you and your family to enjoy. Just like the regular service, registration opens the Thursday before each Sunday service.
We want to offer a kid-friendly service that will assist you and your children in their spiritual journey.
Spa Church will be hosting our annual GLOW event here on October 31st, but we need your help. We are happily accepting candy donations between Monday to Friday, 8 to 4:30, or Sundays during service time. Thanks for all of your participation.
Join us outside on October 31st between 5 and 8 p.m. for safe trick-or-treat. We will also need volunteers. If you are able and willing to help, contact Pastor Nicole at the office.
Are you new to Spa Church? Text WELCOME to 604-210-8606.
There are many ways to give at Spa Church. Check out our website to see how.
We have many groups meeting by Zoom here at Spa. Check out our website to find out more.
Spa Youth meets here in the building Tuesdays at 7 p.m. Contact Pastor Wes for more details.
We meet online every Sunday at 11 for worship, Wednesdays at 8:30 a.m. for 5-minute devos in 1 John.
Thanks for joining us this morning and enjoy the rest of the service. Good morning, Spa Church. We have something great to let you know about today. This is a testimony from one of our Lift groups that decided that they needed to go out into the world and reach the world with the gospel. They did the Great Commission. Because of COVID, the most important thing was to be outside, they thought. So what better place than to go to Surrey Central Station and have a booth set up where they could give away different supplies that are needed at this time for people who were in need. Of course, with friendly smiles behind those masks and gloved hands, they gave away beautiful hand sanitizers, Bibles, helps, and all in the name of the Lord, to give to people who were in need, to talk to them when they most need it, to share a smiling face. And all of these items were all gone in less than 2 hours. This was the Great Commission. This was truly doing what Jesus wanted us to do, to go out into all the world and preach. And here we see this homeless man. As you can tell, he has quite a lot of hair. Well, we had one person who was willing to cut that hair and to talk to him about Jesus, and you'll see his smiling face. You know what else? The RCMP and the transit police came by, and they said, "Thank you to our church for helping in the community." Don't forget, during this COVID time and this season, be the light that Jesus wants you to be. We're grateful that this Lift group was.
Pecadores, encontrem a graça, venham. Kommt, legt sie nieder am Fuße des Kreuz.
Jesus espera tanto mundo amor.
Well, good morning. It is the last Sunday of the month. Hard to believe. But the last Sunday is Mission Sunday, and we celebrate one of our missionaries, and we remember them in prayer for the following month. The missionary of the month for November is ICR, International Christian Response, which is the organization we sponsor that is helping out the persecuted church. What I want to do here this morning is show you a video. Now, this isn't from ICR. This is for the National Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church. But it gives us a good idea of why it's important for us to remember the persecuted church, for us to pray for it, and also for us to give toward ICR, the organization we sponsor. So let's run that video now, and let's remember to pray for the persecuted church in the next month.
All over the world, Christians are separated from family and friends, isolated because of their relationship with Jesus. At 14, Lena had to make a heart-rending choice. Lose everything she knew, including her Muslim family, to follow Jesus in Nigeria.
I was very upset and surprised by my father's attitude because I knew he loved me. But he changed and now he wanted to kill me. I was angry and discouraged. I wanted to become a Christian, but I wasn't sure because it might cost me my life.
The emotional and physical suffering and isolation has only led to a greater determination by Lena to serve Jesus and to love those who have persecuted her. Czech national Peter Jacek, who serves persecuted Christians, was falsely imprisoned in Sudan. Three Sudanese believers were also arrested. During the 14 months he was detained, Peter was held in five different prisons under horrible conditions and was beaten by other prisoners because he was a Christian. But Peter never lost his hope in Jesus.
When I was physically attacked, I was experiencing the deepest peace in my mind. And even though I do not even remember like the pain from those beatings and that moment when I was beaten with the wooden stick.
Every hour I need when temptation comes my way. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. 'Cause Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
Called me Saul once, a Hebrew of Hebrews, faultless in the eyes of the law. But I watched the rebellion growing, and like a fire, it spread. Claims of a Messiah and a resurrection, the Son of God they declared, and for that, I hunted them. My will was bent on destruction, but on the road to ruin, my world was torn apart. A voice called my name and the scales fell from my eyes. The fire that I sought to extinguish was now consuming and refining me. People called me Saul once, but that was another life, for I am a new creation. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And neither death nor life, not even the powers of hell, will separate me from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus.
Well, good morning. Great to see you. Great to be able to be in your home with you and just spend some time looking into the Word of God together. And I hope you are taking seriously this series that we're going through on prayer, the prayer covenant, and developing a relationship with Jesus, coming stronger in our relationship with Jesus daily. And, you know, today we're going to talk about a very important topic. But, you know, before we get there, I just want to let you know, I just did my 52nd wedding here at the church, and it was a wonderful time. Actually, we did it not at the church; we did it in a hall. But 52 weddings, and you know, over the years, I've seen some very interesting weddings. Over the years, I've seen people dress in very interesting ways. I got to tell you, one of the most interesting weddings that I've done was a wedding I did for a couple that wanted to have a Halloween theme wedding, and it was different. They were dressed up. He was dressed up like Frankenstein. She was dressed up like, of course, the bride of Frankenstein. And their whole house was decked out to look a little bit like a castle. But, you know, when you see different weddings, you see people wear different things. Now, some of these wedding dresses are not necessarily something that I would be promoting. Like this dress here, I mean, I'm not too sure about it. Now this one is, I guess she was pregnant and she wanted everybody to know it. I don't know if I would have done that. I would say this one is a little bit over the top. But imagine for just a minute that there is a wedding. And the bride comes walking down the aisle, and she looks like this. She has not dressed properly. She has been rolling around in the mud or whatever, and she's walking down the aisle. Or worse yet, imagine the bride and groom, they're looking like this, and they come walking into the church. And we would be sitting there going, have they lost their marbles? What is going on? And of course, you wouldn't dress like that, or you would dress appropriately for an important event like a wedding. writing. But in the same way, we need to be appropriate in not so much our clothing, but in our presentation, how we are when we approach God. What do we look like? What is inside of us? Again, we are doing the prayer covenant, and the prayer so far has been, Dear Father, thank you for your grace that has made me one of your dearly loved children. By your grace, make knowing, loving, and obeying you my highest priority. Empower me to love others the way you love me. And today we want to talk about repentance. And the prayer is, wash me clean from every sin. See, folks, the important thing is that when we go before God, that we are dressed appropriately in our presentation. Again, not on the outside, but on how we are on the inside. And we're going to talk about repentance. How about we start with a word of prayer? Father, I thank you. I thank you we can come to you. We can bring our needs to you. We can bring our sins to you, that you love us, that you have made a way for us to be free from the bondage of sin. And as we look into this prayer this morning, as we look into the importance of repentance, I pray in Jesus' name you would speak to your people, you would challenge them, you would encourage them, and help us, Father, to truly, truly live a life of holiness before you. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. When we look at repentance, the first thing we need to look at is the depth of what sin really is all about. Now, every once in a while in my home, I have to do something that I really do not like to do. And I am not going to show you a picture of this. But what I have to do is I have to clean up when the cat or when the dog vomits. Now, there is nothing more disgusting than cleaning up dog or cat vomit, especially when it is still warm. I'm like, I'm dry heaving because I absolutely don't like doing that. Now, I wonder, what do you find absolutely revolting, repugnant, or disgusting? Why don't you just maybe make a comment on the comment bar on the side? And what is it that makes revolts you or disgusts you, or is repugnant to you? See, for God, what is revolting, what is disgusting, and what is absolutely repugnant is sin. It is worse in his eyes than cat vomit. Here's what Proverbs chapter 3 verse 32 says. The Lord detests a perverse man. Another version said it is an abomination to the Lord, those that are perverse and do not follow God appropriately. Jesus said in Luke chapter 16, verses 14 to 15, the Pharisees who loved money heard all this and were sneering at Jesus. He said to them, you are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of God, but God knows your hearts. What is highly valued among men is detestable, despicable, disgusting in God's sight. See, we brush sin off like it's like a little mistake or a slip up or even just maybe a little bit of a harmless fun. But it's not like that, folks, in the eyes of God. In the eyes of God, sin is absolutely repugnant. It's ugly. It's disgusting in his eyes, and he cannot tolerate it. It is sin, my sin and your sin, that put his son Jesus on the cross. And of course, he wants nothing to do with sin. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18 says, for Christ died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous. Listen, sin defiles. Sin pollutes, it violates, it corrupts our inward being. It is not something we can take lightly. It is something we need to understand is absolutely despicable in the eyes of our Father. Jesus said in Mark chapter 7, verses 20 to 23, it is what comes from inside that defiles you. From within, out of a person's heart, comes evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, wickedness, deceit, lustful desires, envy, slander, pride, and foolishness. All these vile things come from within. They are what defiles you. We had a girl a number of years ago that used to attend our church. And she grew up in the church. She went through our We College program, which is a program for children to learn scriptures. And she quoted the scriptures. She worshiped in church. She was part of the ongoing programs here at the church. But when she got older, she decided to go her own way. And she found herself involved with alcohol, with drugs, with promiscuous sexuality, and quite honestly, corrupt sexuality, and walked away from the Lord. And I thought, man, how absolutely sad that is. See, she was defiled. Or even to this point, she is defiled. And yes, I pray for her and others like her that God would bring her back. But the truth is, this sin, it interferes with a healthy relationship between us and God. It draws us away from the Lord. And folks, you got to understand something. Sin is evil, and every one of us was born with it. We tell kids that they are done bad things. But the truth is, every one of us is evil from the start. Romans chapter 3 verse 10 says, there is no one righteous, not even one. Ephesians chapter 5 verse 8 says, for you were all darkness. John Piper, a pastor down in the States, he says something that I want to echo here this morning. He says, I am perverted. I am bad. I'm broken. I'm corrupt. I'm proud. I'm selfish. And until I own this, until I, Wes Dyes, own this, the gospel, the good news of Jesus won't land with power. We as all adults need to understand this, and we need to teach it to our children. The kids are broken. They need Jesus. We are all broken. There is a depth to sin that has perverted us, that has drawn us away from Jesus. Please, folks, we need to understand how evil sin is. Wash me clean from every sin, is what the prayer says. Let me go on to a description. In Jerry's book, he gives a description of what is known as the traditional seven deadly sins that is found in the Bible. They are lust, gluttony, which is excessive and ongoing eating of food and drink, greed, sloth or laziness, wrath, which is anger, envy, and pride. Let me ask you this, and maybe you can comment on this. Which of these sins do you think are the most prevalent in our society today? Of all this list that I just gave you, which do you think is the most prevalent today? There is no way we can or we ever want to describe all the different sins that are in Scripture. It would take us way, way, way too long. But I want to focus on a few of them that Jerry in his book, The Prayer Covenant, draws out. And I think it's important we look at this. The first one he talks about is self-righteousness or pride. Let me just say something. Jesus is all about relationships. He's all about developing a relationship with us. We know John 3:16, don't we? For God so what? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. God loves us and wants that relationship with us, and he wants to maintain a positive relationship. But what happens is that relationship is broken when we become self-righteous or arrogant and proudful. Jesus gives a story in Luke chapter 18 verses 10 to 13 that shows how this relationship is broken. He says, two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. God, I thank you that I am not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Can you see it? Can you see it? If we put it in today's day and age, can you see a wealthy, pompous businessman wearing an Armani suit walk into the church, walk up to the front, lift his hands to heaven with a Rolex watch on his wrist, and begin to say an incredible prayer that absolutely impresses everybody in that church except Jesus? But in the back of the room, can you see him? Can you see a man walk in? with a tattered jacket, maybe a scraggly beard, maybe he doesn't smell so very nice, sit down in the back, bow his head, and begin to beat his chest and say, God, I've sinned, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me. The scripture says here that the one that was contrite, the sinner, was honored in the presence of God rather than the Pharisee. See, folks, when we become self-righteous or arrogant, God says, man, I don't want any part of that. I don't want to have you in my space because it's repugnant to me. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5 to 6 says this, but God opposes the proud, but give grace to the humble. Wind is an incredible destructive force. It rips apart roofs like this one. It throws buildings over and send things absolute flying. Have you ever watched someone walking in a heavy windstorm? It can be funny, even fun, but also it can be incredibly dangerous. Feel for this person that gets blown right over like this. And in the same way, it's almost impossible to stand against a strong wind force. It is impossible, folks, to stand against God when we are doing things he does not like. And he is against arrogance. He is against proud. He opposes the proud. He stands against the proud. But it says in verse 6, humble yourself, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift us up in due time. We need to examine our hearts. We need to say, God, is there self-righteousness? Is there pride there? Is there things that need to be made right? Help me to make them right. Help me to be free from these things so that I can stand in your presence. Wash me clean. Wash me clean from every sin. Second sin I want to talk about is lust. Lust is a desire for what is forbidden, an obsessive sexual craving. Nelson Illustrated Bible Dictionary tells us. Matthew chapter 5, verses 27 to 28, Jesus says, you've heard it that it was said, do not commit adultery. But I tell you that anyone that looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. I read about a story about a young girl that went to grandma's house, and she was sitting at grandma at the table, and she said to grandma, Grandma, how old are you? And grandma says, child, you never ask an older lady how old she is. That is not right to do. A little while later, the girl looks at grandma and says, Grandma, how much do you weigh? And grandma said, girl, you never ask grandma how much she weighs. You never ask an old lady how much she weighs. That's just not appropriate. You don't ask questions like that. A little while later, the girl came back to grandma all in smiles and says, Grandma, I know how old you are. Grandma, you're 62 years old and you weigh 140 pounds. And grandma looks at her and says, how did you know that? She says, well, you left your driver's license on the table, and it says that you are 62 years old, and it says that you weigh 140 pounds. But grandma, there's one thing that I also found out. I found out that on your driver's license, it says that you got an F in sex. Now, the truth is, in our society, there are a lot of people that get an F when it comes to self-control and when it comes to sexuality. When it comes to lust, it's a real problem, folks. And as Jesus said, even if we look at an individual as a woman in a wrong way, we've committed lust or adultery in our hearts. See, pornography is an incredible strong force in our world. It worldwide, statistically speaking, it's reported that there is approximately $57 billion to $100 billion that come in through this industry. It is more money that comes in the United States alone that comes in through pornography than that comes in through CBS, NBC, or ABC news networks, which brings in only approximately $6 billion. And it brings in more money than all professional sports combined. That is professional baseball, professional football, and professional basketball. It is an incredibly huge, huge industry. We have a problem, folks. We have a problem when $3,075.64 is spent on pornography every single second. We have a problem when 28,258 users are watching pornography every single second. We have a problem when 1 in 5 of mobile searches is done for pornography. 88% of porn films deal with acts of physical aggression. 49% contains verbal aggression. How does this all affect us? For those that are stuck in this, how does it affect them? Well, first of all, it affects their minds. Pornography, it absolutely distorts the attitudes and perception of a natural sexual relationship in marriage. It absolutely perverts it. And what happens is, and you know all of this, there becomes a higher tolerance for the wrong type of sexual actions, a tolerance for abnormal sexual behavior, a tolerance for sexual promiscuity and aggression, and even rape. We've got a problem. It affects the mind. It affects the body. Pornography is incredibly addictive. Now, I'm not a doctor, and you all know about the dopamines that are released when people are watching pornography. The problem is as any drug, and let me be honest, and let me be straight up, pornography is a drug. As in any drug, when people take it, they want more and they want a heavier dose. And it's the same thing with pornography. They're not happy with a little bit of the stuff. Then they want more and more and more. And it affects the body. Thirdly, it affects the heart. Pornography affects people's emotional lives. Marriages that are involved in pornography, there is less satisfaction, and the relationship becomes strained, and it affects the person's heart. We have a problem. And can I speak to you? If you are struggling with pornography, let me tell you, it's every man's battle. Everybody has a struggle. They have to guard their mind against it. I have to guard my mind against it. And if that's you and you're struggling, can I encourage you? First of all, tell somebody, expose this thing. Tell somebody that you can trust, that you can talk to, and that you can sit down with and say, listen, I need help here. By all means, don't try to do it alone. Secondly, can I encourage you, remove those things that will in any way give you the option to be involved in pornography. Listen, don't watch movies that are pornographic. Don't go to places on your computer that are pornographic. Put your computer in a prestigious place. If you are married, put it in a place where your spouse can see it. If you're single, go to your computer when there's nobody else around, and your devices, maybe put on some sort of security on there. Covenant Eyes, I strongly recommend, or there might be other things that you can put on your devices that will monitor what you see so that you can guard yourself against this. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 8, flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a man commits are outside his body, but he who sins sexually sins against his own body. Flee this stuff. Flee this stuff. Ask God for help. You know, if I had a glass here right now and I were to take it and it would be empty, it's full of air. How do you get the air out? You just fill it full of water, don't you? And as the water fills up, the air pushes out. Can I say to you, fill your life with Jesus. As your life gets filled more and more and more with Jesus, the other junk just overflows. Lord, help me. Wash me clean from every sin. Help us with this problem of lust. Lastly, help us with the problem of broken and unforgiving relationships. Jesus is all about forgiveness. We talked about it before and said Jesus is all about relationship. We mentioned John 3:16 before, how he wants to forgive. And you know, I love the fact that he wants to develop that relationship with us. He wants to help us with those broken relationships. And he wants us to do the same. He wants us to heal up those relationships we may have with others that were broken. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 32 says, "Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you." Listen, let's make this even more impactful. Let's bring this even closer to home about what God expects from us when it comes to relationships and when it comes to forgiveness. Matthew chapter 6 verse 14 says, "For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive you your sins." It's hard to understand why people do evil things. It's so hard to understand why they hurt us so incredibly much. But God is calling us to do something almost impossible, and that is to choose forgiveness. That is to be willing to choose to forgive. Back in 2018, Vicente Rodriguez, he shot to death a 17-year-old boy by the name of Andre Hawkins. And Vicente was sentenced to life in prison. But before he was sentenced and sent to prison, he had to stand before the mother of Andre and listen to her. Here's a short video of that encounter.
Today, before the judge handed down the life sentence, he had to hear from the mother of the teen he allegedly killed in a jealous rage. The grace displayed in her words stunned those gathered in the Kent County Circuit Courtroom.
"In order to get through this process, I had to forgive you, and I forgive you from the bottom of my heart. I pray for you because as a mother, you're a child to me. And in my heart, I have no anger or bitterness towards you. As a mom, I just want to hug you because I know that there's something that's not connected that made you feel so angry.
I just want to say I'm sorry, Ms. Hawkins.
Wash me clean from my sin. Lord, help me to forgive the most difficult people in the world to forgive because you forgave me." See, if we are willing to forgive, then we are willing to receive, and we will receive the deliverance. We will receive deliverance, first of all, from God. Again, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, one of my favorite portions in 1 John says, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." Listen, Dave messed up. He messed up bad. He had sex with a married woman. He had her husband killed, and then he kept it secret for almost a year until he was found out. See, because God saw it. And God sent the prophet to him and confronted him. And David said in Psalm 51 verses 1 to 2, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin." David, he responded by saying, "Lord, I have sinned against you." Did God say, "No, I am not going to forgive you," and beat him up? No. It tells us in 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 13, Nathan the prophet replied, "The Lord has taken away your sin. You are not going to die." See, God desires to deliver us from sin. His desire is to cleanse us from the inside. And so the wonderful thing is that we can receive that deliverance from God, but we can also receive that deliverance from others. I talked about this already in a previous point, but let me bring you to Romans chapter 12 verses 17 to 18. It says, "Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone." Listen, don't be an instigator of trouble, but be a peace lover and a peacemaker. Make it a point to try to develop a positive relationship with everyone around you so that you can be delivered from a negative relationship, but that you can have a positive one. So we need that deliverance towards others. And lastly, we need a deliverance toward ourselves. In Jerry's book, he talked about the importance of seeking forgiveness, but then to forgive ourselves as well. See, God forgives, but sometimes we are the ones that are the hardest to forgive ourselves. Isn't that true? That we beat ourselves up time and time and time again, and we think, man, why did I do that? And let me bring you back to 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. Confess our sins, He is faithful and will forgive us our sins, and what? Purify us from what? From all unrighteousness. Over the years, I've had a number of people come into my office or call me and said, Pastor, God will not forgive me. I have committed the unpardonable sin. I have done something that God will never forgive me for. And they are distraught, and they believe that's it. They're going straight to hell. And I've said to them, and if you have told yourself that God will not forgive you for something you have done, can I just say, if you are broken about it, and if you are repentant about it, you know you've not committed the unpardonable sin. Because if you have, you wouldn't care if you had sinned or not. And I've told them, you know what? Just ask God for forgiveness, and He will forgive you. And then forgive yourself and move on. Folks, repentance is so incredibly important. And I want to end by just saying to you, or asking you, where are you at? Where are you at with your relationship with Jesus? Do you understand the depth of sin? Are you willing to ask God for forgiveness, to repent of it, to turn? Repentance means to turn away, to make a complete turn from what is over here to what is over there. Are you willing to repent from there? And are you willing to give your heart to Jesus 100%? I want to challenge you. If you haven't committed your life to Jesus, would you be willing to do that today? Ask Him to forgive your sins. Commit your life to Him. And then would you please respond by emailing us, by phoning us, but even putting a message on the side saying, I have made the commitment, so that we know, so that we can follow up with you, because we want to help you with the next steps. Father, thank you that if we confess, you forgive. It's so incredibly, incredibly awesome that you choose to forgive, not because of what we did, but because of what Jesus did on the cross. And so I pray for everyone listening to me this morning, wherever they're at, Father, in their living rooms, if they're in their bedrooms, if wherever they are at, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name, you would speak to them, you would encourage them, you would help them to walk in a way that honors you, Father, to live in a way that honors you, to fill their lives with things that honor you. And if they are struggling with some of those sins that I mentioned here today, I pray, Jesus, that they would look to you, they would ask for help, that, Lord, they would look to others for someone to keep them accountable, and Father, they would even reach out to us as a church that we can help them along the road. But God, please, would you just help your people to be strong, to follow you, and to be committed to you. We thank you, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you again for joining me here this morning. Thank you for allowing me to be in your home with you this morning. I pray God blesses you, God gives you an incredibly great day, and that you would continue to walk in ways that honor Him, and in the wonderful freedom that we have in Christ. God bless you. We'll see you again.
Had a plan from the start. Is wrong.